I know I'm taking a risk saying this, but we just might be at peak crazy right now. I know. But I want you to hear me out. I want you to listen to President Trump. This is him at his Ohio rally just a little while ago, riffing on Neil Armstrong and managing to work in a slam at Colin Kaepernick at the same time.
He planted that flag, that American flag, right on the face of the moon. There was no kneeling. There was no nothing. There was no games. There was no games. Boom. Boom. What?
And then, of course, there's Kanye. Everybody's talking about Kanye tonight. Also at the president's rally, Congressman Steve Chabot.
And I never knew I'd say this, but God bless Kanye West.
I wonder who told him how to say the name right. And then President Trump got in another reference to his BFF.
And it's true. Kanye West, what he did was pretty amazing yesterday.
Amazing, that is one word for it. That's one word for it. Kanye's wife is talking about it too. A source close to the Kardashians telling CNN that Kim Kardashian West is not embarrassed by Kanye's comments. The source also says that Kanye's mind moves at lightning speed and suggests that the White House meeting wasn't the best forum to represent Kanye's genius.
There's a lot of things affecting our mental health that makes us do crazy things that puts us back into that trap door called the 13th Amendment. I did say abolish with the hat on because why would you keep something around that's a trap door? If you're building a floor, the Constitution is the base of our industry, right? Of our country, of our company. Would you build a trap door that if you mess up and you accidentally something happens, you fall and you end up next to the Unabomber? You gotta remove all that trapdoor out of the relationship. The four gentlemen that wrote the 13th Amendment, and I think the way the universe works, it's perfect. We don't have 13 floors, do we?
I'm gonna save what I said yesterday, right, that some people left out. If you love this man, he shouldn't be in front of TV cameras. Not that he shouldn't support Trump. Not that he doesn't have the right to say what he wants to say, right? Help him. Help him. Don't double down on it. If I ever got close to doing that even before I came on television, first of all, nobody would let me go on television in this studio, anyone that I know. They'd have my back. They'd say, Don, I don't think you're right yet. I remember when my sister passed, nobody would let me go on television until they felt that I was okay. So if you care about him, really do, and not just the fame, not just the celebrity, not just whatever, then maybe some people are just too close to the forest, can't see the forest for the trees. So I'm trying to say something nice about Kanye. And I'm trying to actually tell the people who know him and who are close to him to help him. He's talking about the 13th Amendment and trap doors and hydrogen planes. And that's fine. But is it the appropriate venue? Is that what you want your loved one? Is that what you want your loved one's legacy to be? Is to be the person who went into the Oval Office and said a whole lot of things that didn't make sense? And then said MF in the Oval Office. Is that what you, okay. So, the president is exploiting Kanye. This is as much his fault, maybe more than Kanye's, because he is the president of the United States. He gave him the platform. He invited the cameras in. And then he let it roll out live for everybody to see. He is taking advantage of a man who needs help. And I'm not being disparaging about Kanye. There are many people in this country who have mental health issues. He admittedly says that he does. And so we should take the stigma off and be honest about it and talk about it, okay? But this is what our politics have become. It's ugly, and it's getting worse. Tough talk about angry mobs. President Trump unloading on Democrats again tonight in Ohio, using the new Republican talking point to slam anybody who opposed the nomination of Brett Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court.
An angry Democrat mob was on a mission to resist, obstruct, delay, demolish, and destroy him. These are bad people. We can't let this happen to our country. Republicans believe in the rule of law, not the rule of the mob. That's what it is. It's a mob.
That's great in front of a crowd of people who agree with you and they're going to applaud everything you say, but I want everyone to remember the real mob here. And that is the white supremacists, the mob of white supremacists who killed a woman in Charlottesville. The only mob I know to have killed someone is the one in Charlottesville. And this is what the president called that mob. Watch.
You also had people that were very fine people on both sides. You had people in that group, excuse me, I saw the same pictures as you did.
This is what our politics has become. We fight about fighting. So listen to Eric Holder just a few days ago.
But Michelle says that, you know, when they go low, we go high. No. When they go low, we kick them. That's what this new Democratic Party is about.
So Congressman Steve Scalise, remember him, unfortunately, he was shot by a gunman at a GOP baseball team practice last year, writing in a Fox News op-ed, when Democratic leaders like Eric Holder call for violence, that is a direct threat to our democracy. So Holder, he tweeted this. He said, stop the fake outrage. I'm obviously not advocating violence. But the president was only too happy to blast the former attorney general.
He better be careful what he's wishing for, that I can tell you. He better be careful what he's wishing
for. What do you
mean? That's a disgusting statement for him to make. For him to make a statement like that is a very dangerous statement.
But you know what? Donald Trump wasn't always so worried about dangerous statements.
I love the old days. You know what they used to do to guys like that when they were in a place like this? They'd be carried out on a stretcher, folks. The guards are very gentle with him. He's walking out like big high fives, smiling, laughing, like to punch him in the face, I'll tell you.
If you see somebody getting ready to throw a tomato, knock the crap out of him, would you? Seriously. Okay? Just knock the hell. I promise you, I will pay for the legal fees. I promise.
Get him out. Try not to hurt him. If you do, I'll defend you in court. Don't worry about it. Part of the problem and part of the reason it takes so long is nobody wants to hurt each other anymore. There are no consequences to protesting anymore. There used to be consequences.
I would have been out there fighting, folks. I don't know if I would have done well, but I would have been boom, 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 I'll beat that.
This is what our politics has become. I want you to listen to this shocking statement. It's from Republican candidate Scott Wagner, threatening Pennsylvania Governor Tom Wolf.
You better put a catcher's mask on your face, because I'm going to stomp all over your face with golf spikes, because I'm going to win this for the state of Pennsylvania, and we're throwing you out of office.
I almost hesitated to play that, to give that guy the attention he so obviously craves. But that seems to be the world that we're living in right now. And there's more. A Minnesota legislator grabbing the mic away from his female Democratic rival. The look on her face right there says it all.
Increases over time with deflation.
There it is again.
Thank you. Oh, I see a rebuttal is required.
Thank you.
Increases.
And even Stephen Miller's third grade teacher claiming that as a child he had weird personal habits like eating glue. Come on. There are plenty of reasons to criticize Stephen Miller for his policies, like the forced family separations at the border, the policy that put children in cages. We don't need to go back to what he did or didn't do in the third grade. But this is where we are right now. Our politics are ugly and getting uglier. We just suffered through a bruising battle that put Justice Brett Kavanaugh on the Supreme Court, and now we're less than a month away from what may be the most important midterm elections in our lifetimes. Can we get back on the rails before it is too late?